Sleepwalkers are those that they have a kind of combination of sleeping and wakefulness. People like this, that they suffer this kind of disorder, are those that they are asleep, but they are walking. You might have heard, or I hope none of you is suffering this disorder. While they are asleep and are fully asleep, yet they are walking, they go to the kitchen, open the fridge, they eat some food, walk off down the stairs. Sometimes they may harm themselves or others because they are really, technically speaking, medically they are asleep. Yet for some strange reasons that is still medically, the causes of that include, as well as the treatment is not well understood, these people, while they are asleep, they do certain things like as if they are awake. And if you see them, you think that they are awake, but they are asleep. The mind is asleep, the body is moving. This is called the sleepwalkers, khabgardha in Farsi, as we refer to. The idea is this, orafa, those who have reached where they're supposed to reach, they say that majority of people, unfortunately, we are all asleep. You think that you are awake. They say once upon a time there was a car accident, a very fatal accident, and they were separating the casualties from the dead. So they grabbed a guy, they were putting him next to the dead bodies. And because he was injured, but he was alive, he turned around and said that, hey, don't put me next to the dead bodies, I'm alive. They said, no, your body is hot, you don't know you are dead. The idea is that majority of people, we may be included among them with all respect, we are asleep, we think that we are awake. We are acting like sleepwalkers. So that if somebody says that, Sheikh, what are you talking about? I was conscious and consciously made a decision to walk or drive to the masjid tonight, attend the program. I'm conscious now, I'm hearing you, I know what you're talking about. Orafa, they say, my friend, we have to double check this because possibly you could be well asleep and you think that you are awake. Let me give you an example. Someone very close to me so many years ago, he's been, and because most of you, perhaps all of you, you experience somehow in your life as you are experiencing, perhaps not for the second generation, especially the elderly ones. Has anyone experienced being homesick, being away from your family and friends? Someone very close to me, he shared this experience with me that many years back, I was away from my family for many years. And naturally, I became homesick and I was missing them. Every now and then, I fall asleep. I see my mom and dad, brothers and sisters, friends in my dream. And I wake and I'm happy that, alhamdulillah, I made it back home and I see and I'm enjoying the company of all my family members. And again, I wake up and I realize, oh, that was only a dream. Until he said once in my dream, again, I experienced seeing the family members and I was rejoiced. But I said to myself, I bet you this is another dream. While I was dreaming, he says, I decided to check if I'm asleep or not. I said, you know what? The best is just wash your face. While I'm dreaming, this is part of the dream. Now we say dream. To him, it was reality. You all know that if you have ever experienced dream, normally we don't know we are dreaming. We think that it's real. Huh? He says, in my dream, I just splashed some water on my face and washed my face. I said, no, alhamdulillah, this time I'm awake. Guess what? After that, he wakes up again. Ah, that was again another dream. This is the story of sleepwalkers. And that's why Amir al-Mu'minin, salamullahi alayhi, he says, An-nasu niyam fa'idha ma tuntabahu. Majority, the mainstream, people are asleep. We are on the train of time and the train is running so fast and we are sleepwalkers, talking in dream, eating in dream, doing everything in our dreams, let alone after we leave the world of dreams and all the ambitions that we have, but that's what I want to achieve, what I want to do later on. We live in the world of dreams like sleepwalkers. So the first station in practical Irfan is that we need an alarm clock to wake us up. Even for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the very first chapter surah that was revealed to the Prophet, inshallah you all know that, was Surah Iqra, Surah Alaq, Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. That was to appoint the Holy Prophet as the messenger of God, to declare, to announce his prophecy. The one after, the next surah is this, Surah Muddathir. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Ya Ayyuhal Muddathir. Muddathir is the one that is like, imagine that in the cold night here in Denmark, you are enjoying a cozy room and covered yourself with a blanket. The one who is like enveloped himself or herself in a blanket, covered himself, is called Muddathir. The Almighty God is addressing the Prophet, says, Ya Ayyuhal Muddathir, meaning, my Prophet, that you have just covered yourself. Qum. Simple meaning of Qum is get up. We respectfully translate it, arise. That's why I said that the topic for tonight is let's get up. We want to get up from our dream. Qum fa'anzir. If you want to warn, if you want to preach, you have to wake up yourself. Otherwise, the one who is asleep, Tabibun yudawi an-nas wa huwa 'alilu. I cannot treat someone if I'm already sick, I'm suffering myself. Qum fa'anzir. You have to wake up, arise, and then you may be able to warn others. Wa rabbaka fakabbir. Throughout the talk, inshallah, we'll learn more about it tonight or in the coming weeks. Wa rabbaka fakabbir. Glorify your Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa thiyabaka fatahhir. Purify, and your clothing, your garments, your pajama, your clothes that you are wearing, fatahir, purify. Remember, I told you that in fiqh al-asqar, in lesser jurisprudence, thiyabaka fatahir, it means that if your clothes is najis, wash it. Thiyabaka fatahir, in the journey of Irfan, it means this thiyab is your body. You have to purify your body. The body, your soul. It's not talking about this clothing. So, ثِيَابَكَ فَطَهِرْ has a different meaning. وَالرُّجْزَ فَهْجُرْ. Like, stay away from the idols where idolatry was practicing. Again, in practical Irfan, we'll learn, inshallah. I touched on that last week. Remember, I told you that Ayatollah Hassanzadeh was saying, don't associate with non-mahram. In practical Irfan, رُجْز, idols, it means non-mahram. Dissociate yourself, stay away. What's the keep away from the idols, including yourself, including your ism, your egotism. You have to stay away from them if you want to wake up. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So, how am I supposed to wake up? How am I supposed to know if I'm asleep or I'm awake? I give you a test, inshallah, tonight, very practical test. Remember that our story is only half an hour, 1 hour maximum, once a week. The rest of the week is the exercise, whether we do it or not. And unless we do it, if you don't do it, inshallah, time will come that you decide no longer I'm going to this practical Irfan session. Because you see that assignments are piling up and haven't done anything, so you just give up. From the very earliest stages, please remember that unless we put it into practice, otherwise time will come, we will not be able to continue. I mentioned that to wake somebody up naturally needs an alarm clock. In the future, inshallah, I'll speak to you if you have this habit, bad habit of you put your alarm, but the moment that the snooze goes off, you just hit it and go back again to sleep. That somebody was saying, why are you putting this alarm if you don't get up? It's just a habit, and shut it up, and again sleep. Another 5 minutes, another 10 minutes, until all of a sudden shaitan says, now you may wake up. The sun is already in the sky. That's a trick of shaitan. But that's not the story for tonight. We need an alarm clock. The alarm clock in this journey is that unless you and I feel the pain, and you and I are really concerned about the way that I'm living my life. If you remember last week, I gave an assignment respectfully. I said, reflect on this ayah, فَأَيْنَ تَذْهَبُونَ. The way that you live your life, what's the direction that you are heading? Are you sure you're on the right track? اِهْدِنَا الصَّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. If I'm not on the right track, the way that I live my life, then that means I'm asleep. Because impossible, I'm conscious, I'm God conscious as a Muslim, mu'min, who knows the truth, who knows about life after death, who knows about what will happen to me after I die. And yet I don't live based on my knowledge, that means I'm asleep. I'm not awake yet. I have not started the first station in this journey of perfection. So to check whether I'm awake or not, I have to examine every individual tonight. Inshallah, we go back home, those who go back home, and they think about this. Do I feel pain about the present situation, the way that I live? See, there is a difference between feeling pain and the source of pain. Often people, when they feel the pain, or like, for example, when you are feverish, they get upset. Why part of my body is aching, or why I'm feverish? On the contrary, feeling pain is an alarm clock that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has instilled in your body, in my body, to alarm us, hey, there is a problem somewhere in your body, isn't it? Imagine that we get sick, there is a virus in our body, and no fever comes. We never go for treatment. That's why certain kind of diseases that they don't have apparent symptoms, we don't go for treating them until all of a sudden the whole body is affected, unfortunately. So feeling pain is definitely a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, both for our bodies as well as our souls. Now I want to check whether my soul feels that pain. If you feel that pain inside yourself, and I'm not here to flattering you, but inshallah, you had that kind of feeling of pain. Otherwise, you would not have motivation to make all the way come here tonight. So that in itself is encouraging, but we need to build it. We need to put more effort into it. An initial feeling of pain has motivated you. No, I really have to go see what this has got for me, because I'm not satisfied with my lifestyle. The way that I'm living my life, I'm not satisfied. Do we have anyone in medical field here? Anyone is familiar with analgesic drugs? Analgesic drugs are drugs that are like, while you are conscious, typical example is like paracetamols, Nurofen that you take. When I have a headache, for example, or any kind of aching in the body, a paracetamol like a Nurofen, what do you have here, Panadol, and things like that, painkillers, we call them painkillers in English. Any of the painkillers that you take, you don't feel the pain anymore. The pain is there, but the nervous system are not transmitting the pain to the brain anymore. The connection will be lost, and therefore you think that my headache is gone. This is called painkiller. This is called, in medicine, analgesic drugs. The argument that Urafa they have, unfortunately, most of people today, many of us, including us Muslims, we have taken painkillers. And that's why we are content with the way that we live our lives. We don't think that I need to improve my life anymore. And I give you an example so that, inshallah, especially the youngsters, inshallah, they can relate to it better. Let me just translate. I was told that it's a mixed gathering, Farsi, Arabic, Danish. I don't know Danish, but English. So I'm making with my PowerPoints Arabic, English, and some Farsi in it as well. The reference to what I say is this beautiful poem of Rumi. I read it and translate it to you. For feeling the pain and the benefit of feeling the pain, if we truly feel the pain inside ourselves, the pain of dissatisfaction with myself, the pain that I really feel that I'm like, as if I'm suffering from a cancer spiritually, and I have to treat it, I have to kill it, I have to do something about it before it's too late. Rumi says, look, ta nazarat teflake nazuk gelu, kei ravan gardat zepestan shiru. Unless the baby cries, the mother is not going to give him the milk. Once the baby cries, the mother says, oh, my baby, I think, is thirsty or hungry. I have to feed him. Ta nagirat madaran ra dard zeh, tefl dar zadan nayayat hich rah. Unless the pang of delivery comes, the baby is not delivered. This is the benefit of the pain. From this, they want to bridge to our discussion that unless you truly have that pain and feeling of pain that I'm not a good guy, really, I'm not on the right track. Surely I can do better than this. Otherwise, there is no chance for improvement. خواندن بی درد دل مردگی است. خواندن با درد دل بردگی است. He says, imagine two people that are reading a supplication, like the Akumail. I'm sure we all have seen. Someone is reading so quick. Another one is reading the Akumail and is in tears. He's so emotional. The one who has no pain is just reading it as a routine, including our Salat, is like that. The one who has come to the masjid because he's desperate. Someone very dear and near is dying. And he's told that Dua Kumail does miracle. And he's come to the masjid and prays. You can see that he's reading from his heart. And unless it's coming from your heart, no tears will come. Hasrat o zari gah bimari ast. Waqt bimari hame bidari ast. He says, unless you feel the pain, you are not awake. If you truly feel the pain inside yourself, you have the motivation, and then you are awake. And much of the journey is done because you are on the road. You get to the road. Otherwise, you are off the road, and off the track. پس بدانین عصر را ای عصر شو هر که را در دست او برده است شو. If you see that the scholars, some of the great scholars, a friend, a very close friend came to me, he said, Sheikh, I went to Mashhad and mashallah, I saw a very eminent scholar. You could tell like he was a very great scholar, old and looked like a mujtahid, and he was crying around the dharih and the holy shrine of Imam Ridha alayhi salam, asking Imam Ridha for forgiveness, like as if there's no tomorrow, like as if he's committed and I don't know, very mortal sin. I said to myself, la hawla wa la quwwata illa, may God help me, look what he has done, that he's really crying like this. I said to him, as a matter of fact, if you had the chance to see Imam Ali, you would accuse Imam Ali more than that. Because when Imam Ali alayhi salam was reading Dua Kumail, he was reading it like the one that is bitten by a snake. The narrators who were around Imam Ali alayhi salam, they say he was reading Dua Kumail, weeping, crying like someone who is really suffering from the pain. Not because of the sin. I said, brother, they are in a different level. They are conscious, they are awake. Depending on the level of our consciousness and our awakeness, it shows how we live our life. Anyway, so Rumi says, those who are more awake are more alert. If you want to be alert, you need to wake up yourself. Now, an example of this. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Back in early years of my all end of teenaging, I had enrolled by the grace of God. Ajabe bakshid. I had enrolled by the grace of God to the Islamic Seminary of Qom, first year of studying, many years ago. Most of you were not born back then. And they put me, it was normal to put you in the dorms that you live in the dormitory, you would have a roommate. I was type of a student that I didn't like to have roommate because I wanted to make use of my time, and roommate, we sit, chit-chat, and all of a sudden midnight has passed, we are too tired, we go to sleep, we do the study tomorrow, and it never happened. I preferred always to be by myself. Again, the next room, knock, knock, knock. Hi, Lagai, are you there? Do you like to have dinner together? Habibi, I don't have time to eat dinner together. Leave me alone. What I ended up doing, because back then I was improving my Arabic, so to improve my Arabic, I used to read the short Arabic stories. You all know that this is a way to learn a language. One of the short Arabic stories is what I'm sharing with you tonight, alhamdulillah, after many years. The story is the following. Once upon a time, a Bedouin, an Arab, in a very hot area of God knows Arabian Peninsula, he was ice seller, ice blocks. He was selling the ice blocks, and because it was a hot day, naturally his capital was melting so quick. For some reasons, that day so happened that nobody comes to buy ice. What's wrong? These people, they don't want to have cold water. So he realized that his capital is melting. He turned and said, Ayyuhannas, irhamu man ra'su malihi yadu. Don't I have the translation? Yes. Oh people, be kind to me. My capital is melting. Please be kind to me. My capital is melting. Now, one examination for tonight and from tonight onwards, especially the youngsters. Sometimes with my children, with all respect, or youth, when I sit with them, I said, you know, you guys are so rich with time because you are young. And you think that your saving account of time is so high, skyrise. You're a billionaire. Time, because time, I'm talking about time, not money. And that's why you lavishly spend. You think that this youth and time always stays with you. You spend hours and hours wasting your time for nothing at all. That shows you are still asleep, with all respect. If you were only awake, you would be so mean and stingy to your time. As Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, inshallah, I bring the hadith to you next week or in the coming weeks, Imam Sadiq alayhi salam says, I'm so blanin, I'm so stingy when it comes to my time. You wanted something, you asked a question, I answer the question, please make your time, make your way. You're most welcome. Leave me alone, I've got things to do, I've got life. Plan, manage your life. Be stingy when it comes to your life, because your life is the capital that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you that is irreplaceable. Money, if you lose money, it can come back. Your account balance went down, again it comes up. But the fact that the sun today set, it will never come back. Subhanallah, let me read this poem, beautiful poem, Farsi poem, and translate it to you. در قطع نخل باغ سرکش در قطع نخل سرکش باغ حیات ما چون اره دو سر نفس اندر کشاکش است. The poet has a very nice example here, a very nice parable. He says that sow, you know what the sow is, menshar, arre. The sow, if it's two-sided, yani when you are like, it's going and coming, both ways it cuts quicker. He says our breathing is like a sow, that inhale and exhale is cutting the tree of life. Every year that you want to celebrate your birthday, brothers, sisters, remember at the same time is a commiseration as well. Because it is your birthday, but remember they say, how old are you now? They don't say how young. My friend, you are only getting older. That means you are only losing opportunities. Be an opportunist. Take advantage of opportunities. Don't lose them. If you are lavishly spending the days, the hours, the minutes of your life, that shows that you are still asleep. Because you're losing your capital and you don't realize it. Inhale and exhale, life is cutting the tree of your life. And if say, oh, Sheikh, if that's the case, I don't breathe, then there's a shortcut to death. So either way, we are on the train of hitting the grave. We need to be conscious of this. If the riwayat says that one of the very influential contributing factors to wake us up as an alarm, think of your death. Time to time, go to the cemetery, walk around the graves, and I've done this assignment with the youngsters. I told them, go to the cemetery and come back with the youngest person died here. Date of birth, date of death. You will be surprised how many died before you. You don't need to get to your 80s, 70, or whatever to die. Nobody knows when, where, and how. So that's how this capital is fragile, that we may use it. So this is just one simple example. Two issues, and inshallah I will finish here. Tranquilizers is the same as that painkillers that I told you, tranquilizers in our journey. First, worldly engagement. We are so engaged, somebody went to the jungle and said, there are so many trees, I didn't end up seeing the jungle. We are so engaged in our worldly affairs, as we say, we are so much caught in the rat race of dunya, that we forget about Akhirah, and forget about our destination. I'm so busy, inshallah tomorrow, sofa, sofa, sofa. This will never happen. We have to start it now. World engagement, and there is more to elaborate, I'm just sharing the headings with you. And again, I want to emphasize on this, brothers and sisters, unless we dissociate ourselves from the non-mahram, there is no chance for improvement. People who come to me, I've had like those who are on the alcohol addiction, gambling addiction, drug addiction. I tell them that, look, my friend, if you don't change your circle of friends, don't waste my time and your time. Nothing is going to happen. You have to change your lifestyle. You have to change people that you are associating with. And now you're familiar with the non-mahram and mahram concept in Irfan that I was talking about. I'm not talking about male-female things. I'm talking about those that when you see them, you remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those that when you associate with them, you feel more spiritually elevated. Such people are mahram to you. Those that association with them is just bring you to dunya and dunya, and you feel after that your heart is dead. These people are non-mahram to you, even if they are your sibling. Remember this. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Quickly review assignments for last night. You're lucky that I'm not checking who's done, who's not done it, because it's a volunteer session. It's up to individuals. Yet, I really want to reinforce and reemphasize, please, please, pretty please, make sure you do it. It's to your advantage to do it. Otherwise, la ikraha fiddin. The Prophet did not force, who am I to force? Remember, we mentioned about wudu, especially when you go to bed. Quickly, a footnote here. Some brothers and sisters, maybe I'm also included, to be frank with you, they say that in the cold winter here in Europe, it's really difficult to maintain our wudu during the day sometimes, especially for the ladies at work, difficult to get changed and may renew the wudu. I told you that, I said, at least now, when you want to go to bed, make sure you make your wudu, sleep in the state of wudu. Start, this is not difficult, you're at home. Make your wudu, show to yourself, to your soul, and discipline yourself that, look, I care about worshiping the whole night. How generous God is that says you make your wudu and sleep, and I write for you 6, 7, 8, how many hours you sleep? In this sense, the more the merrier. How generous God is by making wudu, writes for me 7 hours of sleep, worshiping. And look how stingy I am. And I see, I just go to bed like a donkey, with all respect. Make your wudu before you go to bed, at least to start it. Congregational prayers, I mentioned, and I want to reinforce it again so that we remember it. Once you pray on your, there is 1 degree for you in paradise. If you do jama'ah, attend the jama'ah, and the number of those who attend the jama'ah exceeds number 10, you are already elevated 25 degrees in paradise. Just by attending jama'ah prayer, habituating yourself, making it as part of your lifestyle, that you care about jama'ah prayer. That Imam Sajjad alayhi salam says, driving all, not driving, for him was cameling, for you driving all the way to masjid to attend one jama'ah prayer is worth it. Don't miss such opportunities. And the assignment for tonight, this is Zikr Yunusiyye. وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا Zikr Yunusiyye. Long story short, Zikr Yunusiyye, which is La ilaha illa and Subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin. Inshallah, you know the background of the story in Surah Al-Anbiya, that Prophet Yunus, he left his community that he was not supposed to abandon them, yet he did. And then, long story short, they throw him to the sea and was like swallowed by a veil. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, then he realized that that is a punishment to discipline him from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the stomach of the veil, he started glorifying God. La ilaha illa and subhanah, glory to you. Meaning that you are the one that is free from any defect, sin, mistake, or anything. Inni kuntu min al-zalimin. This dhikr is kind of istighfar, asking God's forgiveness. So because in that situation, he, instead of blaming God, how cruel God is, and blaming others, he turned to himself and acknowledged, it was my mistake. I made a mistake that I'm suffering now. Inshallah, in the future, we'll have more to relate to this. La ilaha illa and subhanak inni kuntu min al-zalimin. Our teachers would give us this as very early adhkar for the beginners who want to start. This is one. There is a hadith from the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi wa sallam that the Prophet says that when you are ill, sick, God forbid, remember to read this, because much of our illness is payback of the sins we have committed. So at the time of illness, or when you visit a sick person, teach them La ilaha illa and Subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin. If by the grace of God and with the power of this dhikr you are recovered, you will be recovered La zamba alay, sinless. You are forgiven. And if it's the will of God that I have to, with this illness, to depart this world and die, then the Holy Prophet says, you will have the reward of shaheed. Allahu Akbar, a martyr. Do you see how generous Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with this dhikr? And of course, when I say this adhkar, I don't mean just lip service to it. We have to say it until it becomes part of our subconscious. And that's why they say the best position is when you are in the state of sijde. In the sijde, get into the habit of saying this dhikr, la ilaha illa an subhanaka inni kuntu minal zalimin. And I promise you the last benefit that I can mention, of course, here for this dhikr yunusiyah to entice you, inshallah, encourage you to do it, is that Imam Sadiq alayhi salam says that if you were ever grieved in your life, and who can say that I've never been grieved? If you are going through some hardship in your life, man kana maghmuman, agar gham o ghusse dari, if you are grieved, la ilaha illa, and let that be your dhikr, daily basis, night, every time, bayn al-tulu'an, any opportunity. Our teachers were saying that there are adhkar like this one, that the more the merrier. There is no restriction when and how many times. The more the merrier. Imam Sadiq alayhi salam says this because I heard the Almighty God after that saying that la ilaha, the rest of the ayah is this, la ilaha illa an subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin fastajabna lahu wa najjaynahu min al-gham wa kadhalika nunji al-mu'minin. That's why this dhikr is relieving the grief, because the following the part, the rest of the ayah is that God says that because Yunus said this, fastajabna lahu, we granted his supplication, wa najjaynahu min al-gham, we rescued him from the grief. And don't think that it's only for Yunus. Wa kadhalika nunjil mu'minin, rule applies to every believer. Every believer's practices this, will read the same reward. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. And I apologize that I quickly have to run away and don't stay for the Q&A. Otherwise, I'm going to miss my train to Hamburg. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.